Tonight on NewsWatch, the president's ambassadors. Why some say Mr. Obama's picks could be putting the country's security in jeopardy. Plus, crisis in Crimea. Why some are pushing for the peninsula to separate from Ukraine and join Russia. And a look at how coconut oil may be helping Alzheimer's patients improve. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Good evening. I'm Lori Johnson. President Obama has come under fire as some question the competency of his nominees to represent America as ambassadors around the world. Now the Union for Foreign Service Workers says it will file suit if the State Department doesn't release the nominees' certificates of demonstrated competence, which are required by law. White House correspondent Jennifer Wishon has more on why the group is so concerned.
It's been more than 20 years since the American Foreign Service Association weighed in publicly on a president's pick for an ambassadorship. The group serves as the union for America's foreign service workers. And after watching the recent confirmation hearings of President Obama's nominees, members couldn't stay silent.
The ambassador speaks for the U.S. government and the American people and the president.
Soap opera producer Colleen Bell nominated as ambassador to Hungary. Hotel tycoon George Soonis nominated as ambassador to Norway. And political consultant Noah Mamet nominated as ambassador to Argentina. All earned their chances after bundling big money for the Obama campaign. But after watching their performances during their confirmation hearings on Capitol Hill, members of the association felt they had to speak up to keep Americans from getting ripped off.
Mr. Mehmet, have you been to Argentina?
Senator, I haven't had the opportunity yet.
There are a lot of markets that will continue to open up.
Let me just ask, as ambassador, how would you promote those trade cooperations?
Thank you for that save, Senator Johnson.
There were several moments when the nominees appeared to need saving, but critics argue the stakes at America's diplomatic post are too high for failure. Just look at the crisis in Ukraine.
37% of ambassadors appointed by President Obama have been political, but career diplomats say problems with political appointees didn't start with the Obama administration. And they say there are examples of America missing opportunities abroad because her top diplomat in the post wasn't qualified.
Other countries do not send campaign donors to the United States as ambassadors.
Federal law says campaign donations shouldn't be a factor in the selection of an ambassador. In an effort to encourage the selection of more qualified nominees, the association has spelled out a list of guidelines.
They're common sense. It's requiring leadership experience, understanding of the host country, the country to which you're being assigned.
It's the president's prerogative to nominate ambassadors and the Senate's prerogative to confirm them. But America's diplomatic community hopes these latest gaffes encourage whoever is in the White House to be more selective in these important choices in the future. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.
The Obama administration has announced another major delay in Obamacare. The White House will let insurers keep offering health care plans that don't meet the law's requirements through 2016. That will prevent another wave of policy cancellations this fall, weeks before the congressional elections. The move will help Democrats avoid more bad news over Obamacare. Right now, polls show Democrats could lose control of the Senate. The 2014 Conservative Political Action Conference kicked off today just outside the nation's capital. CPAC is the largest gathering of conservatives each year. The three-day event will bring in some of the GOP's biggest names, including likely 2016 Republican presidential candidate contenders. Among those set to speak this year, Chris Christie, Rand Paul, and Marco Rubio. Texas Senator Ted Cruz addressed the crowd this morning, telling the GOP it's time to stand up for something.
You want to lose elections? Stand for nothing. Look at the last four congressional elections, 06, 08, 10, and 12. Three of the four, we followed that strategy. 06, 08, and 12, we put our head down, we stood for nothing, and we got walloped. The one election that was a tremendous election was 2010, when Republicans drew a line in the sand. We said we stand unequivocally against Obamacare, against bankrupting the country, and we won an historic tidal wave of an election.
Our chief political correspondent David Brody is at CPAC, and he'll bring us a complete wrap-up after the event. And for more from David, make sure you check out his blog, The Brody File. It's at cbnnews.com. Turning now to the situation in the Ukraine, the U.S. is turning up the heat on Russia, even as diplomatic efforts in Paris go nowhere. And as the international community tries to de-escalate the crisis over Ukraine, officials in Crimea are seeking a way to separate. Heather Sells has the latest.
Ukraine is on edge. In the eastern part of the country, pro-Russian demonstrators stormed past police and took over a government building. In Crimea, armed men threatened the UN special envoy, and Crimean officials have announced a public referendum on March 16th. Their hope, separate from Ukraine and become a part of Russia. Ukraine calls it unconstitutional. And President Obama is condemning the plan.
The proposed referendum on the future of Crimea would violate the Ukrainian constitution and violate international law. Any discussion about the future of Ukraine must include the legitimate government of Ukraine.
Washington took steps today to penalize Russia for invading Crimea. The State Department announced visa bans on pro-Russia opponents of the Ukrainian government. And the Treasury Department announced financial penalties for those who undermine Ukraine's new democracy. The U.S. is also moving to increase the scope of international observers in Ukraine.
We find the fact that the monitors have had extreme difficulty in getting into Crimea, in performing their activities in Crimea, is very worrying.
The Pentagon is now sending 6 extra fighter jets to the region to monitor any Russian airspace violation. And NATO is suspending plans for a joint mission with Russia.
We have put the entire range of NATO-Russia cooperation under review.
Despite the mounting pressure, there's no indication that diplomatic talks with Russia are progressing, and there's growing concern that Russia will press forward into areas of eastern Ukraine as part of a grand plan to create a Eurasian Union. Ukraine, with its 46 million people, could help make that happen and help Moscow pull more former Soviet satellite states back into its orbit. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Nearly one-third of Syria's chemical weapons have been destroyed or removed. That's according to the group in charge of destroying the country's stockpile. The Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons says Syria's government has accelerated its elimination efforts after missing several important deadlines, adding that March is a critical month to accomplish its mission of ridding the war-torn nation of its chemical arsenal by the June 30th deadline. Syrian authorities submitted a revised plan to complete the removal and destruction of the weapons by the end of April. The Israeli Navy intercepted an Iranian weapons shipment on its way to terror groups in the Gaza Strip Wednesday. The shipment contained dozens of long-range rockets. Chris Mitchell reports from Jerusalem.
Israeli defense officials said they tracked the shipment for months.
Over the last months, the Israeli intelligence has gathered, has continued to gather extensively in order to intercept this mission that Iran was trying to carry out.
The shipment included dozens of M302 missiles with a range of between 60 and 120 miles. Those strategic weapons would have put millions of Israelis and cities like Tel Aviv and Jerusalem within rocket range and represented a new level of danger to Israel's home front.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said the weapons shipment reveals the true face of Iran.
Iran is smiling, talking soft in the international forums, but it continues unabatedly its aggressive behavior in the Middle East and beyond. It's sending the deadliest weapons to the most cruel terrorist groups and despots like the Assad regime. It has not changed one iota its aggressive policies. I think it's critically important to prevent this terrorist regime from having the weapons of mass death. This regime must not be allowed to have nuclear weapons capability.
The seizure lifts the veil on the ongoing daily covert war between Israel and its enemies, what Israel's chief of staff Benny Gantz calls the war between wars. The IDF released a video tracing the route of the missiles from Syria to Iran, onto a civilian ship at an Iranian port, and then into the Red Sea, where Israeli naval forces intercepted it hundreds of miles away from Israel. Some analysts called the seizure the biggest arms shipment in more than a decade. The ship is under tow now and expected to arrive into the Israeli port of Eilat over the weekend. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Members of Congress are speaking out for persecuted Christians. Two Republicans gave Ash Wednesday speeches condemning widespread attacks against Christians in the Middle East. Alabama Congressman Bradley Byrne said the U.S. should continue aid to countries like Egypt and Iraq on their treatment of religious minorities. Frank Wolf of Virginia asked American Christians to show more support for suffering believers. Coming up, spying on lawmakers, a look at new allegations facing the CIA. Troubling new allegations against the CIA. The agency's internal watchdog reportedly asked the Justice Department to investigate whether some of its agents may have spied on high-level lawmakers. The head of the CIA denies the claims, but it's picking up steam on Capitol Hill. Caitlin Burke reports.
For 4 years, staffers for the Senate Intelligence Committee investigated a top-secret CIA program aimed at pushing terror suspects to the breaking point. Now lawmakers say the CIA was monitoring that investigation, violating the constitutional principle of separation of powers.
CIA agents reportedly searched the computers of committee staff members, trying to learn how they gained access to the CIA's own 2009 review of its interrogation program.
Now many senators are crying foul. In a letter to President Obama, Senator Mark Udall said, quote, "The CIA has recently taken unprecedented action against the committee." And Senate Armed Services Committee Chairman Carl Levin said that if true, it's, quote, "an extremely serious matter that could violate federal law." Even former members of the spy agency are troubled by the reports.
It sounds like an aggressive CIA trying to protect something, within our own government. These counterintelligence investigations are meant for foreign governments or even press leaks, but not directed against the Senate.
But the CIA is pushing back. Some officials have implied that it's actually the committee staffers that acted out of line, penetrating part of the CIA's computer network that they weren't authorized to access. CIA Director John Brennan said, quote, "I am deeply dismayed some members of the Senate have decided to make spurious allegations about CIA actions that are wholly unsupported by the facts." Brennan went on to say he's confident authorities will determine where wrongdoing, if any, actually took place. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Up next, the non-medical treatment that's helping Alzheimer's patients improve. Far more people may be dying from Alzheimer's disease than have been reported. The Centers for Disease Control says nearly 85,000 people died from Alzheimer's in 2010, but that number should really be closer to more than 500,000, according to a study from Rush University Medical Center in Chicago. That would make Alzheimer's the third leading cause of death in the U.S., not far behind heart disease, which is number one, with nearly 600,000 deaths in 2010, and cancer with 575,000. Well, 5 million Americans currently have Alzheimer's disease, and that number is expected to greatly increase as baby boomers age. But one product may be helping. For some, coconut oil is slowing the progression of Alzheimer's.
Steve Newport's Alzheimer's disease has slowed considerably. Some of his symptoms even reversed, thanks to an unlikely treatment prescribed by his wife, Dr. Mary Newport, a physician who runs a neonatology ward at a Tampa, Florida hospital. She became determined to help her husband after he failed the so-called Alzheimer's clock test.
He drew a few little circles and several numbers just in a very random pattern, didn't really look anything like a clock. And the doctor pulled me aside and she said, you know, he's actually on the verge of severe Alzheimer's at this point. He's beyond moderate. So That was very, very devastating news.
Dr. Newport began learning everything she could about her husband's disease.
It appears to be a type of diabetes of the brain, and it's a process that starts happening at least 10 or 20 years before you start having symptoms, and it's very similar to type 1 or type 2 diabetes in that you develop a problem with insulin.
In this case, insulin problems prevent brain cells from accepting glucose, their primary fuel. Without it, the cells eventually die. But there is an alternative fuel, ketones, which the cells easily accept. Ketones are metabolized in the liver after you eat medium-chain triglycerides, which are found in coconut oil. So Dr. Newport added coconut oil to Steve's diet. Just 2 weeks later, he took the clock test again, and as you can see, demonstrated stunning improvement.
I thought at the time, was it just good luck? Was it a lot of prayer? Was it the coconut oil? And I thought, well, we're going to keep the coconut oil going.
Then 3 weeks later, he took the clock test a third time and continued to get better. And it wasn't just intellectually. He also improved emotionally and physically.
He was not able to run. He was able to run again. He couldn't read for about a year and a half. But after somewhere around 2 or 3 months, he was able to read. Instead of being very sluggish, not talking very much in the morning, he would come out, you know, with energy and talkative and joking, and he could find his water and his utensils.
Dr. Newport documented Steve's success in a book called Alzheimer's Disease, What If There Was a Cure? She received this stack of thank you letters from other people whose loved ones' Alzheimer's was helped after they followed Steve's diet. And while coconut oil is encouraging, there's actually something much more powerful. A team of biochemists led by Professor Kieran Clark at England's Oxford University have developed a ketone ester that packs a punch 10 times greater than coconut oil.
It reaches quite considerably higher levels, and you can get whatever levels you want depending on how much you drink.
The problem is they need millions of dollars to mass produce it.
Very expensive. And so we can't make very much of it ourselves. And what we would like is funding so that we could actually scale up and make it. But of course, there's no real profit in manufacturing stuff like that.
So until a high-potency ketone ester is available to the general public, coconut oil is still a good ketone source. Just make sure it's pure, non-hydrogenated. Avoid any hydrogenated oil, which is the same thing as dangerous trans fat.
Many people avoid coconut oil because they think it's bad for them, but it's actually very healthy.
Dr. Beverly Teeter is a researcher at the University of Maryland who specializes in dietary fats. She says years ago, coconut oil was criticized for raising cholesterol. But scientists have since learned there are two kinds of cholesterol, LDL, the bad kind, and HDL, which is very good for you and is the kind coconut oil raises.
So they put out the message that it increased serum cholesterol, but the truth of the matter was it was helping the profile of the serum cholesterol. That never has been corrected in the public press, and I think that's the reason people have misconceptions about it.
So not only does coconut oil improve your cholesterol levels, Dr. Teeter says the way it helps the brains of some Alzheimer's patients can be extended to people with Parkinson's disease, ALS, epilepsy, dementia, even schizophrenia and autism. And one more thing, coconut oil is a natural antibiotic that also helps kill viruses like HIV and herpes viruses.
But the coconut oil tends to keep the bacteria down so that if you're assaulted with a virus, your immune system can concentrate on the virus. It doesn't have to concentrate on 27 other bacteria that you may have been exposed to that day.
So consider coconut oil to improve your overall health and perhaps even go so far as to stave off life-threatening diseases.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and we put it in food a lot.
And since I first reported on that story, Dr. Newport was flooded with letters from Alzheimer's caregivers whose loved ones saw improvement with coconut oil. Not from everyone, but from enough people that the Byrd Alzheimer's Institute in Florida is currently conducting the first ever scientific study on the effects of coconut oil on Alzheimer's patients. And of course, we'll let you know the results of that study when it's complete. If you'd like to learn more about the benefits of coconut oil, go to our website, CBN.com. Up next, a rescue caught on tape, how bystanders stepped in to save three children. Our final story tonight is a little different. It has a happy ending in part. The good news is three children are safe after being rescued from a minivan their mother drove into the Atlantic Ocean at Daytona Beach, Florida. A tourist captured the drama on video Tuesday. Police say the pregnant mother, 31-year-old Ebony Wilkerson, drove her van onto the beach and into the ocean. Trapped inside were her three children, ages 10, 9, and 3. The children could be heard screaming for help as the strong surf was pulling them further into the ocean. Lifeguards and bystanders rushed into action to rescue them.
By the time I ran over, I get there, I noticed the son was snatching at the wheel, trying to get her to come back towards the shore.
And there's one kid in the back seat just screaming, you know, help us, help us. Our mom's trying to kill us.
Earlier in the day, police had stopped Wilkerson in her car after a 911 call from her sister. She told them her sister had problems with her husband and was talking about demons. Officers say she appeared okay and let her go. She's now undergoing a mental evaluation. The story is a good reminder of how important it is for us to pray for hurting people, and there are a lot of them out there. Well, that's all the time we have for this edition of NewsWatch. Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com.